thank you guys. So I'm Madhav. So I work for Analyttica Data Labs, an organization. So we are an AI/ML platform organization. We focus on solving different ML and AI problems by providing scalable technology solutions to our clients. And so today I'll be talking about a solution that we have developed from a marketing perspective, the inception of which happened when we got one of our clients asking us to develop a media mix solution for one of their brands for a national, metropolitan, and regional level marketing. And so the customer is Toyota, and what they had approached us was for their car brand Corolla for the Australian market segment. And as part of the solutioning that we have developed for them, you know, as part of our thinking and ideology, we wanted to kind of bring them a solution which can be integrated with their systems. In a traditional manner, media mix marketing solutions are very effective. They focus on getting the ROI for different marketing channels. At the same time, they are very, very laborious, and they take a lot of effort to be built. And sometimes the sense or the insights that are there are lost in terms of how they can be implemented quickly at scale. So one of the solutions that we are providing to them that we had developed is that they should be able to run this almost on a real-time basis. It has the ability to ingest data from different sources, be it external or internal. And at the same time, they should be able to realize the impact of the ROI and the optimization scenarios that are very, very essential from a marketing mix perspective. So with that little bit of background, let's move ahead. So before we jump in, I would just like to ask in terms of, you know, why media mix modeling? Like, why are we doing this? I see a few familiar faces at the back. Any answers, any guesses? Why you focus on media mix modeling? Absolutely. So I think when a lot of media mix modeling started, it's been a science which has been available for a long time. There are practitioners who are experts. So additionally, it started with different media channels, like which are more traditional, I would say, like a TV ad, a radio ad. You would see a newspaper print, magazine prints. And then the idea was, you know, if I have a lot of, if I have money as an organization, how do I spend it across each of these channels? But with the boom of technology, with the digital coming into play, the social media, this has gone just to the next level. Now, today, you don't only have your TV, media, print. You have your social media. You have emails. You know, you have your different profiles coming on the internet. So then you still have that same corpus of money, but the channels where you want to focus on to divide that corpus, the budget, has increased. And you want to be very, very prudent about where you spend that money, because you're trying to identify and maximize that ROI, that, you know, if I have to spend an extra 100 rupees on TV, is it better if I do it on TV or if I do it on radio versus if I do it in a magazine or a print or digital? So with that advent, the overall choices available to the marketers have increased. At the same time, the complexity to measure that ROI has increased as well. And also the time taken to have that effectiveness. If I even analyze the ROI, how do I implement it effectively and get back my results? That's also increasing potential of opportunity for different marketers to have solutions. So today, in a traditional setup, if you were to think about, you would start building a media mix model, you have your different channels laid out, you'll have your marketing budget laid out. Once you have a model available, you'll start running your optimizing scenarios to see which works best for me, how can I do that? And this exercise can take anything between 4 to 6 months to a year. But at the, in the same time frame today, with everything moving so fast, your marketing landscape would have changed. So you want this to be done very, very quickly and still efficiently so that you're not losing on money. So how do we do that? But before we jump into the solutions, I will just kind of walk through a couple of concepts in terms of how do marketers start focusing on measuring these ROIs. So we'll start talking a couple of concepts before we jump into solution. So these are the advertising concepts about advertising ad stock, where there are two important aspects that one needs to focus on while trying to measure the effectiveness of different channels. One is the decay effect of advertising, and one is the diminishing returns or saturation effect of advertising. So let's see what does each of these mean. So from a decay perspective, it means that today when you want to start focusing on spending some money on an ad, be it in any of the channels, when you start focusing on, in the, let's say, the given time zero or week one, when you put in the money and the ads goes out, that has the maximum effectiveness of the ad. But it doesn't mean that tomorrow, when you are not spending money on the same ad again, does everyone forget about it. So today it was a long drive for me. I'm sure a lot of us had a long commute. You might have listened to the radio, might have seen on the cell phone what's happening. You might have seen a few billboards. You might have seen that, you know, some of it you will remember. You might remember a radio ad, etc. Now, once you have listened to that ad, that advertising impact or that ad stock remains with the customer for some time. Now, that how the decay factor happens, that in week three, can I remember the same ad if I don't hear it again? For some aspects, yes. For some, no. So if I see a TV ad, for example, I might still be able to recall, yes, something is there. If I listen to a radio, I might not be able to recall at all. If I see a billboard, I might not even recall by the evening. So every different media channel has a different decay factor, and that needs to be taken into consideration when you're trying to understand what would be the impact of my marketing dollars spent in a given channel. And here again, so for example, from a mathematical standpoint, in this equation that we see, where AT is basically my ad stock at a given time, which would be a function in a very, very simplistic format, which will be a function of my spend in time t, as well as lambda into AT minus 1. Now, AT minus 1 is my ad stock at t minus 1. Now, t minus 1 can be a day, a week, a month, a year. It depends how we have kind of structured our data, what data is available to us, and how we take it forward from there. So we are not only trying to understand how my ad stock will function over a period of time, but I also want to understand what my lambda should be. It becomes very, very important that I'm not trying to let my lambda or my slope of the curve be too fast or too slow, because then it can have an impact on how I calculate the effectiveness of my media channels. The second concept that we have is what we call a saturation effect, or a diminishing returns effect. So as you see, for example, in the given chart, let me stand here. So in the given chart, it looks like an S-curve, but what it really means from a media perspective, that if I start spending some dollars, there would be an inflection point till which there is a minimum threshold. So if I were only to spend, let's say, $100 to run one ad today, the effectiveness of that ad campaign will not be there. There will be no ROI, there will be no effectiveness. So I have to get to a minimum threshold before I can start seeing what is the impact of my advertising. And this holds true across channels. Now, the frequency and how much you need to spend, the effectiveness will vary across channels, but this holds true across channels. And also, there is an inflection point after which no matter how much you spend on your advertising, your incremental impact will not be there. So if you take, for example, Uber, everybody knows Uber today. So if Uber runs out millions more ad today, it will not change their incremental impact of marketing. So you have to also be very, very focused on when do you start. So what is your minimum threshold? And when do you stop? What is your saturation? And again, this holds true across different channels. And how you estimate that where is my threshold and where is my inflection point, that can happen through different transformations, as we call it. Now, what we see here is a common industry practice, what we call as a S-curve, where you're seeing at the starting, when I start spending my dollars, it will increase. It will increase to a minimum threshold. It will start showing me returns to the inflection point. Once it goes beyond an inflection, it starts reaching saturation. That means I should stop spending more money on my marketing for that specific channel. So I have to optimize my spend across different channels, because these thresholds of saturation and inflection will be different for different channels and different mediums, and even for different geographies as well. So at a national level, I could have a different inflection point for my marketing. It can be different at a regional perspective. So my different segments of customers can also drive these aspects. So overall, it becomes a very complex problem where we have too many moving parts now, where first I have to understand what is my lambda, which is nothing but the rate of decay of how I start losing my impact of advertising over time. Second is, what kind of curve does my channel at my ad will follow to say that I have the right inflection point and I have the right saturation point. So that's where our market assumptions today lie. So there has been a lot of research till now. There have been solutions available where a lot of marketers have tried to focus on that, you know, let's go ahead with the assumption of the S-curve, that all channels follow the S-curve, and we can focus on optimizing the lambda. That is trying to say that all my different marketing channels and media, they follow the S-curve in terms of my threshold and saturation, but I will try to control in terms of the decay factor. That's where our solution objective lies, that we want to break these two myths. So these have been good assumptions, good industry practices. They have yielded very good results. But today we have the power to have more data. And I think there is also a need and effectiveness to realize that power of data to get quicker results as well. We have too many digital campaigns running across social media, across different channels. The speed to execution has changed, and we have the data to capture that. So we are trying to leverage that data to say, can I not only just focus on my lambda, but can I also focus on what is the distribution that should be followed, which gives me the optimal inflection point and saturation point. So this is what I'll kind of walk you through in terms of the solution that we have built. So coming back to our business problem. So the business problem was, as I mentioned, there's the Australian subsidiary of a world car maker, which was Toyota in this case. They were trying to figure out an optimization budget for their different marketing ROI for their car brand Corolla. And they wanted to understand, you know, what can the different parameters that it can be applied through. They had done their marketing across different channels, which include very, very traditional media aspects. So I can show in terms of, so they had about 32 months of time span data. They had 15 marketing measures, 7 ATL marketing variables, and they had 3 level of segments in terms of geography. So they wanted to do that at a national level, a regional level, and a metropolitan level. So this sort of increases the complexity of what we are trying to do, because now the same channel can have a different impact based on a national, regional, or metropolitan level in this case, because the segment of customers and how do you focus from an ATL marketing perspective can change as well. So where does we focus on in terms of applying the solution? So what a solution does is it takes into consideration, it first of all doesn't take the assumption that we will follow an S-curve and the lambda that that we are trying to optimize should not be predetermined. So a lot of times marketers would start with an assumption that, you know, a decay curve can be 0.5 or less than 0.5, and then they start optimizing from that perspective. What we are trying to say is we have designed an optimal algorithm which optimizes not only the shape of the curve to tell us what should be the inflection point. It also tells us at the same time to optimize what my lambda or decay rate should be for each and every specific media channel. So for example, if there are 3 media channels that are running, then it will start focusing on trying to identify the optimal combination of the distribution as well as my decay rate. And it will try to build that the media mix model equation. So for example, in most scenarios, you would use a format of a linear regression for a media mix model. Now, this can be a pooled regression, this can be a sequential equation modeling. So there are different types of equations that can be applied from a regression perspective. So you can, from a prototype perspective, you can actually choose the type of equation you want to build in as part of the algorithm. You can choose what would be your parameter on which you would say that this equation is a good fit or not. As well as it also tries to give you a forecast on the sales, and you will try to say that my error in terms of not just the fit of the regression line, but also my mean absolute percentage error in terms of what my predicted sales are and actual sales are, they should be also minimized. So we take about 2 of these major components to say that as part of my solution, when I'm trying to say if S-curve is a good fit or any other type of transformation is a good fit with a specific lambda, which is the decay rate, where do I find that minimum RMSE for my regression equation? And again, minimize the mean absolute percentage error from my actual versus predicted sales. So as we develop this solution, we have kind of also ingested this in our technology platform called ATS Precision, where today we have the ability to connect to different types of data sets, be it again internal, external. So it can be connected from a web perspective for a live web feed as well. And then as the data flows through, you will have the ability to choose the different parameters on which you want your solution to be optimized. Now, once you have chosen the parameters, for example, would it be an RMSE, would it be a p-value or a f-statistic based on what how you want to sort of focus on your regression model, and then have a fit for your mean absolute percentage error. Based on those parameter selections, it will start running to find the optimal solution for the fit as well as the decay factor. One constraint that we allow to add to this solution is that we keep the decay factor between 0 and 1. The reason for that being that if the decay factor goes below 0, it becomes negative, then it almost says that your marketing will have a negative impact if you start spending more dollars on it. Ideally, this can be a scenario where the ad itself is wrong or the messaging is wrong, but inherently from empirical evidence, we have seen that both good and marketing tends to have some kind of an impact. And usually from a sales perspective, if that is your objective, a negative sales is very, very hard to get. So as we try to then run our solution for all these different types of parameters, for the decay factor as well as the type of transformation that you would want to apply, so we started with something called as a very, very simple model, where it was no ad stock. So we did not apply any transformations to the different type of marketing channels and let the model run. And then we started introducing different types of transformations. For example, in this case, we allowed for a simple decay, a log decay, exponential, negative exponential, and a logistic. So logistic is an S-curve. And based on these six different types of transformations, we got an optimal ad stock model, which gave us a minimized RMSE as well as a minimized MAPE to get that our regression model was a good fit in compared to if all my marketing channels were to follow, for example, a S-curve or a log decay or a simple decay. And similarly, in terms of my prediction of actual versus predicted sales, again, we have the minimized MAPE that gave us that, you know, our overall predicted sales model was doing well as well. So each of the components of this equation now will tell me that what is the lambda or the decay factor associated with each of those marketing channels, and what is their threshold limits as well. So I am not going to share the equation of the model, but I can share the different types of transformations that were applied. So for example, so there were about 15 odd parameters that came out significant, and they have been clubbed into different types of transformation that happened. So for example, from an exponential decay, or let's start with the logistic. So that is the S-curve. So only 4 of the marketing parameters came out to align with an S-curve, with an optimized lambda. Rest of them were following a different exponential. For example, exponential decay had a direct mail. There was negative exponential for 2 parameters, and simple decay for 2 parameters, and log decay. So again, now if you were to start this exercise in terms of I have to start optimizing my parameter or my decay factor along with the type of transformation, this can be a humongous effort. And now if we start focusing on applying this exercise to get a result in the right time frame so that these insights can be made useful, usually we'll run out of time. So that's why we have tried to put this algorithm as part of the AI platform where it can almost help you get the effectiveness based on your solutions and data in a very, very quick time manner. It can be real time, but again, real time would not make a lot of sense here because you're not going to optimize your ROI budget every day. You'll want to put in some budget, you'll say what is my optimal parameters that are coming out, try to run for it. Now that time period can be a day or a week or a month. So that frequency you can choose to run for that. But again, this will give you the optimal results compared to, you know, what a traditional approach will end up doing. And again, you will have the ability to choose what type of parameters and models, regression models that you want to focus on to be applied as part of the prototype. And the platform gives you the ability to play around with that as well. So I think that was a quick, a few key takeaways, as I was saying, I think I've covered this. So again, we started this journey with the automotive industry model, but again, our prototype and the solutions are industry agnostic. It's a high performance and computationally effective algorithm that runs on the platform, as well as it's a unique solution because we have tested out and we have tried to file for a patent on this, where we are saying that there has been enough research done on trying to optimize the decay factor, but how you start focusing on the optimization of the decay as well as transformation functions. So that's we have kind of filed and it's under review. So thank you for that. Any questions? We'd like to take that. Yes, please.
Yeah, thanks, Madhav. I think that was a very comprehensive presentation. When you prepare the data and for this thing to work, I think one of the important prerequisites is for you to be able to attribute conversions to the marketing dollars spent, right? So in one of your slides, I saw cinema to be one of the channels, right? So it's more like an offline channel. So how were you able to attribute conversions for an offline channel like that? And so that's the first question. The second question is more on your modeling process itself. So you mentioned a lot of different techniques for decay techniques to predict the ad stock parameter. Now, is that are these modeling techniques only to predict that decay factor, or is it also to predict the ROI? You mean, sure. You know, that includes the other parameters, other variables?
Sure. So to the first, I think I'll just answer that later. For the ROI perspective, so the overall model when it comes out, so the each coefficient for the marketing channel will have the coefficient basically. And that coefficient will be used to then run a scenario, which the platform allows you to do. So based on the budget that you have and the scenario you want to run, you will be able to take a estimate that, okay, if I were to spend $100 more, what is the incremental impact for a given channel? So the ROI would be computed from that perspective. The modeling technique will give you, which in this case we applied a pooled regression model, which gave estimate coefficients for the right transformation function, what was the optimal decay between a 1-0 constraint. So it will give you the decay factor estimation, and ROI would be calculated on your optimization of the scenarios that you run.
Okay, so you have an optimization solution also in the pipeline, where
yes.
You try out all the possible different decay factor values to and then eventually decide which decay factor gives you the maximum ROI. Is that something like that?
So the solution today will give you the optimal decay factor. Once you have the decay factor based on the budget and how you want to play around with that budget, that
Got
is
it.
The scenario building exercise, which again the solution allows you to do. But that is more from a business manager's perspective, how I want to play around with the information I have. Because they would not focus on in terms of how do I build the algorithm. But they want to, they are consumers of the algorithm. To your first question, which was,
attributing, yeah, sure, not a problem. Attributing offline. Conversion offline, for offline channel.
Right, so given this is a car sales brand, so we try to attribute in terms of, you know, different inquiries going through the dealerships. So now these dealerships can also have walk-ins and different inquiries. They can be sales which were declined, let's say, because they didn't have the right credit history, so because it's an Australian market. So from that perspective, we tried to had a transformed variable to say that, you know, these are the attributes that we'll use. And then that transformed derived variable was transformed based on the right distribution and decay factor. And our dependent variable here was units sold. And so that basically then we converted that into a dollar amount to say from a sales perspective, how can we attribute the two ends?
All right, thank you.
Sure. Yes.
Can you give us some more details on how you do the search and the solution space? Like if you have controlled random search, right?
Yeah, so in the controlled random search, maybe can you explain something specific to this use case that maybe some tweaks you had to do or something?
Sure. So we ended up using the controlled random search here because, again, the idea is the controlled random search as a function itself tries to find a local minima across different planes available. And given that we are providing a constraint to the decay rate of between 0 and 1, we wanted that it not to be limited in terms of the number of runs I run, but let it go and find out in the local minima, can it find the optimal solution? So every time a model is run, it is then saving the RMSE and MAPE values. Then if it will check for the next run if these are lower or not. Very simple to, let's say, from a robotic perspective as well, right? Where you're trying to measure the distance between what action I'm doing. So every time it will keep continuing to search the local minima. And once that local minima is reached, it will expand its horizon to the next set of minima. That's why we focus on the controlled random search piece. But there are other optimization techniques that you can apply. We did not find a lot of success with that. So that's why we thought to start off with this there, and definitely we can, you know, improve as needed. Hey, Anish.
Hi, Madhav. Nice to see you again. So my question is, why did you restrict the upper limit of the AdStock parameter to 1? Like, I understand the 0 factor,
yes,
but why did you restrict the upper limit to 1?
So first thing, this is not a planted question. We just know each other. But yeah, I think the idea was that, you know, we don't want this to be exponentially growing. So again, from a controlled random search, now if I increase, if I don't give my upper bound basically, then it'll continue to find the next plane available. And then it just goes into a loop. So I then have to give it a cutoff in terms of that it should stop at least at a number of iterations. And in that scenario, I might not find the optimal result.
Okay, I get that. But in terms of business, what happens is your ad stock factor basically tells you that your advertisement was good enough that your effectiveness lasted for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So once you restrict it to 1, it basically says that within 1 week, your effectiveness is getting halved. But in terms of business scenario, many a times it happens that you do advertisements so that it has a higher impact, like it has a long-term impact.
Absolutely.
So that's what I was wondering, because even when we do the market mix modeling, what we come across is that many a times there are channels which give you a much higher ad stocking variable. Something like a TV will have much higher,
yes,
compared to a digital video or a social media, which will have probably 0.5 or somewhere around that.
Absolutely right. So again, I think the decay factor is not here in terms of the time sensitive, right? Because a time can differ for different businesses. For example, in your case, you're taking a week. In a car sales, a week might be a very short period of time. So it can happen that we might want to change this algorithm based on the constraint based on the domain we apply for. But it's a good point that, all we're trying to capture here is, based on the given time period, can I get that optimal minima for a given localized spaces? And that's why the constraint. But it can be changed.
Sure. Makes sense.
I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
One is that, what is the time horizon you look at to calculate the ROI that you are trying to measure? And second is, how do you select the population on which you model it in the first place? Because usually there are a lot of biases coming in from other things that happen in every company. So
absolutely,
how do you handle these two things?
So from a ROI perspective, from a time frame, that depends. That is more of a business manager's call. Like, I can try to find an ROI for a week of marketing. I can try to find an ROI for a month, for a year. It's completely. So usually the way it happens is that, even when you start out from a strategy perspective, you will have a longer term investment solution and say the ROI from each of these strategies. But by the time it comes down to execution and measuring the effectiveness, you will definitely take a shorter time frame than a year, for example. So that is a call based on, a lot of things in terms of how your economy is doing, what kind of data you have. So, but that's predominantly a business manager's call. But as a solution, it is flexible to change in terms of, what kind of time frame you're focusing on. And second is in terms of the population selection. So again, we are, as part of the overall thing, one of the biggest challenges, I think, in this industry is data. But again, you can get into a segment level marketing ROI selection as well. So where today, we are trying to move towards more of a personalization, which is a segment of one. But at that level, the attribution becomes very, very difficult because, as you said, even what's happening from a competitor standpoint, we might have to have a lot of data to just prove that, what attribution was because of my marketing dollars versus what was my competitor doing.
Okay. Another question, that if you have 4 different media channels and you have different kinds of decay methods that you explained, so your method will also select decay rate along with what decay method works for a particular media?
Yes.
It outputs both?
Yes. So it will try to find the optimal solution based on that combination. Okay, so I think we are good. Thank you, everyone.